خلقه كما يحبه ويرضاه. اللهم صل على محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وسلم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. ربنا يسر ولا تعسر وتمم بالخير وبك نستعين يا فتاح. First of all, give all praise and all thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the favors and bounties Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed on us. And we send salat and salam on his last and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As we continue with the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are on the journey which is known as the migration, migrating from Makkah to Medina. Last week we dealt with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being in the cave of Thawr. He remained there for 3 days. He remained in that cave with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. It is mentioned that he left Makkah on a Thursday. It was a Thursday that he left Makkah and he stayed in the cave for 3 days. And then on the fourth day, he left the cave and he started the journey towards Medina. On the fourth morning, the guide came, because before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left Makkah, he had hired a guide, as you mentioned, and that guide was an unbeliever. But because of his experience and his trustworthiness, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had given him that task and had paid him already. His name was Abdullah bin Ariqat. Because of his skills, he had known all the shortcuts and all the different routes to reach Medina. So he took them on an unfamiliar route to Medina, a route that most of the people would not take. Because at that moment, a lot of people were searching for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the entire Quraysh. So when this guide came, he brought 2 camels. And he gave one to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam mounted one of the camel. And the second camel, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he mounted on that one. And his freed slave came with the guide. The freed slave of Abu Bakr, his name was Amr bin Fuhaira. He was the one that used to milk the goat during the day and send it for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he came and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu placed him on his camel behind him. And he was there as a form of khidmat, to do service for both Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr. So they left and they went on the journey, trying to reach the Medina safe. The Quraysh had dispatched many people to search. And to even make it more interesting, they made a proposal of a reward of anyone to capture. Anyone was to capture either Abu Bakr or Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's going to get 100 camels. So 100 camels were plenty. So everyone were enticed by that and everyone started a search. They wanted to get that 100 camel, so they were in search of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr. On the way to Medina, there was a family who were the parents of Ma'bad, who would have been Abu Ma'bad and Ummu Ma'bad. They were parents of Ma'bad. And the mother, who was known as Ummu Ma'bad, she was very, very hospitable. Anyone that passed through that direction, she would always invite them, and whatever she had at home, she would always give them something to eat, something to drink. And when Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was on that same route, he saw the tent of Ummu Ma'bad. And he told the guide, let us stop by the tent for a little while. So they sought permission to enter, and only Ummu Ma'bad was home at that time. But it was in such a situation that she had nothing to give to them. Normally, anyone that passed there, she would give them something to eat or drink. So she said to them, she apologized to them and said, you know what, I'm sorry, but today I have nothing. I have nothing to give you, to offer you to eat. I have nothing to offer you to drink. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he saw that there was one goat that was in a corner. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, what happened to that goat? She said, that goat is very weak and very frail. All other goats have gone out to graze, and this goat, it is so weak that we cannot take it out with the other goats. So it remains here. It has no milk, it can't do anything, it is just alive. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked her, if you give me permission, I would like to milk this goat. She smiled and she said to him, you could go ahead. It is all yours. If you could get any milk from this goat, then go ahead, take it and drink. Because to herself, she knows that definitely this goat is not going to have any milk. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went by the goat and he took his hands and he held the udder of the goat and he started to pull and milk started to flow. A lot of milk. She sent containers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to fill containers. And the first person that he gave to drink the milk, for especially for her to believe that it is real milk and it's not something to deceive the eyes, he gave it to Umm Ma'bad. He said, you take the first drink. She drank it and she was very surprised. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He gave to the freed slave that was there, which was Amr bin Fuhaira, as well as he gave to the guide. All of them drank to their fill. And yet, all the containers were still filled with milk. All of that milk came through the blessed hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He milked the goat and all of that milk. She was so shocked and astonished that she accepted Islam. At the same time, she said, definitely you have to be the messenger of Allah. And she accepted Islam and she took a pledge of allegiance to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he continued on his journey. In the evening, when the husband came home, who was Abu Ma'bad, when he came home and he saw all these containers were filled with milk, he asked her, where did all this milk come from? And then she narrated to him the entire incident that took place, that this man, he came and he's the messenger of Allah and he milked this goat that didn't have any milk at all, and all of this milk came from the blessed hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Ma'bad, he also was astonished and surprised, and he said, definitely this has to be the last and final messenger. And he said, I want to go and reach him in person. It's mentioned that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had reached into Medina after some time, Abu Ma'bad went and he accepted Islam with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as well. There's another incident of an individual. After he heard, his name was Suraka bin Malik. He was sitting one day, this is after the proposal came of 100 camels for anybody that captures Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam or Abu Bakr. He said that I was sitting and a man came and he started to say, I saw two men, they were on the road and they were going in that direction. And the two of them, I did not know if they were really Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr or they were someone else. But I've never seen them before. Suraka bin Malik, he was sitting and he asked him, describe these two men for me. And then he started to describe them. When he described them, Suraka bin Malik, he knew immediately that this is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Umar radiallahu anhu. Sorry, Abu Bakr and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he knew. But he didn't want anybody to go ahead of him. So he said in front of everyone, no, that is not the two of them. That is not Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is not Abu Bakr. That has to be someone else. That description doesn't fit the two of them. And secretly he told his slave to prepare his horse and to take it in such a place that nobody could see his horse. When the slave went and prepared the horse and put it in a certain direction, he went, mounted his horse, and he went off with a speed, because he wanted to capture them before anyone else, because he wanted the 100 camels that was offered. And he started in a speed to try to catch up to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr and the guide and so forth that was there. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he looked back and he saw this man in a speed heading towards them. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he says, today we are caught. Definitely we'll be caught today. Look, there's no spider web to help us now. In the cave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped them by using the spider web. But how would we be saved now? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "La tahzan, inna Allah ma'ana." Do not worry, Allah is with us. Just as how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was with us in the cave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is still with us. Allah is still there to protect us. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and caused Suraka and his horse. And immediately as he made that dua, the horse started to sink up to its knee, and then it stopped sinking up to its knee. And even Suraka, his foot was also held in the oars, so he couldn't move, neither his horse couldn't move. It was just like how Haman, that is mentioned in the Quran, how he was sinking in the oars. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused Suraka and his horse to sink in the oars. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they went to reach him. When they meet up to him, he started to beg, plead with them, "Please make some dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove me from this so that we could be free." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the horse were freed, as well as Suraka bin Malik. And he was so happy, he said to them, "I'm going to turn away anyone that is coming this direction. Anyone that is coming this direction, my help to you is I'm going to turn them away." As well as he gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr some provisions, which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam refused. They did not want to accept any provisions from him for that journey. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "Do not inform anyone of our whereabouts. Do not tell anyone that we are on this direction. Do not tell anyone of our condition. Just keep it a secret." And Suraka bin Malik, he turned away. And anyone he reached, he would say to them, "Nobody is in that direction. There's no use you go there. I've already went all that direction and there was no one there." And he ended up turning away anyone from going in that direction, except for Buraida al-Aslami. Buraida al-Aslami, he with 70 men went there to sort for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was the leader. And this happened after Suraka bin Malik had already reached back. And then Buraida al-Aslami, he took these 70 and now they were headed. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was already far, very far ahead, very close to Medina. So they went, 70 as well as Buraida al-Aslami. They were in pursuit. Again, Abu Bakr, he was always keep watching back to see if anybody is following. And he saw this entire group of people coming behind them, searching for them. And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Again, what are we going to do? Allah protect us with a web. Allah protect us from Suraka bin Malik. Would all of this entire group of people, with the entire 70, be sink? Would they sink as well in the earth?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Do not worry." Because he knew that Buraida did not know him. So he's in search for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he didn't really know the full description of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he allowed them to reach up to him, and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, "Man anta, who are you?" And Buraida, he says, "Ana Buraida, I'm Buraida." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he turns to Abu Bakr and he said, "Oh Abu Bakr, why are you worried? Our situation has been cooled down." Because the word Buraida comes from the word Bardun, Bardun, which means to be cool. So Buraida, his name itself comes from the word to be cool. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, his name is Buraida, so definitely our affairs is going to be cool right now. Do not worry. And then he says, asks him, "Which tribe are you from?" Buraida, he says, "I am from the Aslami tribe." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Abu Bakr, "Look, oh, we will definitely be given safety. We'll definitely get safety because the word Aslam, which means we are going to be safe on this journey." And then he asks him, "From which clan in the tribe are you from?" He says, "I am from Banu Saham." Banu Saham, the word Sahman, which means share or portion. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "Definitely today you're going to get your full portion. You're going to get your full share," referring to Islam. "You're going to get your full share of Islam." And then Buraida, after answering all these questions, he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Man anta? Who are you?" And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Ana Muhammad bin Abdullah Rasulullah." I am Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the son of Abdullah, the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the same man he is searching for. The entire 70 of them were searching for him. But after the conversation with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Buraida, he accepted Islam. He said, "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh." He accepted Islam. And not only him, but the entire 70 also accepted Islam. And this entire 70 with Buraida, they accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the migration. They also migrated at the same time with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Buraida even advised the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that before you enter into Medina, you should have a flag to show that your entrance, you're going to enter into Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't have a flag with him, so he took his amama and he wrapped it around one of his spears and he gave it to Buraida and he says, "Use this as your flag." And Buraida went ahead of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to lead them into Medina, and they reach the outskirts of Medina. There's a place 3 miles south of the outskirts of Medina which is called Quba. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he entered Quba first and he stayed a few days in Quba. So a lot of the companions, Quba is not that far from Medina, from the actual Medina. So a lot of the companions who are already in Medina, they came to Quba to welcome the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every day, a group of the people from Quba, they would stay by a place called Harra, and they would wait there to see if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to come or not. And one day when they were going to leave, one Jew, he was on the hilltop and he shouts out to them. He says, "Ya Banu Qila, hada jaddukum." He says, "Oh children of Qila, your source of good fortune has come to you." And when they heard that, they realized that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is coming. So they were very happy, decided to recite poetry, there were a lot of happiness. There were a lot of takbirs being recited as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered into Quba. And when he entered into Quba, he stayed at the house of Kulthum bin Hadam. He was the one that hosted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in those few days in Quba. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he stayed at the house of Khabib bin Isaf. So they were staying at different houses that were hosting them. It is mentioned that Ali radiallahu anhu, he was already there. We know Ali radiallahu anhu, he was in the bed of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stayed in the cave for 3 days as a form of hideout. And soon after the incident, Ali radiallahu anhu, he left and went to Medina. So he was able to arrive in Quba before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was waiting there for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam reached the Quba, Ali radiallahu anhu was there. Even Umar radiallahu anhu came from Medina and he went to Quba to wait on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Ali radiallahu anhu was hosted by the same person that hosted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he was staying in the same house. And the first thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in Quba was to build a masjid. This was the first move he made, was to establish a masjid in Quba. And this is considered to be the first masjid in Islam. There were, Masjid al-Haram was always there, Masjid al-Aqsa was there, but after prophethood, the first masjid that was built was Masjid Quba. This was the first masjid built after the prophethood of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it is right to say it is the first masjid in Islam. First masjid by this ummah was Masjid Quba. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he took a rock to show them the direction of the Qibla. At that time, the direction was the direction of Masjid al-Aqsa, not the direction of the Kaaba. So he showed them the direction that they need to build it, focusing the direction that they had to face. And Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with the companions, they all started to build this masjid. And it's mentioned that Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would lift very heavy rocks. It was so heavy that he would brace it onto his stomach, and the companions, when they saw him like this, they would say to him, "You put it down. Put down this rock. You do not need to do all of this hard work. Just sit, we are going to do it for you." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is one occasion that he recited the dua, "Allahumma la aisha illa aisha al-akhira," which means, "Oh Allah, there's no good living except the good living of the next life. There's no kind of comfort except the comfort of the next life. This life is just for us to work and make a lot of effort." So he wanted the blessings. He didn't want to sit down and just see the masjid being built. And this is a lesson for us. Many of us in this ummah, especially the leaders, they feel that it is too small to do certain job. They're too high to do certain job. You ask them to go and sweep, they'll say, "I can't sweep. I'm higher than that. I can't go and wash a few wares. How could I do that? I'm a mufti. I'm an imam. I'm a sheikh. How could I do that?" This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He could have just sat down and do the dictator's work, saying, "What? The two of you bring that. Put that there. Do this. Do that." This is how the leaders normally do these days. They just sit back and do dictating what and what needs to be done. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not like that. And this is why he had so much of following. This is why the people loved him, because they saw him doing whatever he told them to do. Even for work like this, there's no one greater than him. And look at the type of job that he was doing. He didn't mind, because this world is not about a world of arrogance. This world is not the world to have pride. This is not a world to feel that you have position and you have certain titles and you can't do that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he demonstrated that to us, that this world is the world for us to work. And this is what he did. So he was a part of helping to establish this masjid. And when the masjid was completed, Allah revealed the ayat of the Quran to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is found in Surah Tawbah, verse 108. Allah said, "La masjidun ussisa ala taqwa من أول يوم أحق أن تقوم فيه فيه رجال يحبون أن يتطهروا والله يحب المطهرين." Allah says in that ayat, certainly the masjid which was erected on taqwa, the masjid was erected on taqwa. He says, it's the first day that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam built that masjid. It was erected with taqwa. It is ahaqqu an takumu fi. It is most befitting that you pray in that masjid. So if you're in the area of Quba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying the masjid is there now, you need to pray inside that masjid, in Masjid al-Quba. He says, "Fihi rijalun yuhibbuna an yatatahharu." Allah says, in Quba, you have men that are living in Quba that they love to purify themselves. Wallahu yuhibbul mutahhirin, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he loved those who purify themselves. So when this ayat was revealed, especially this part that talk about there are men in Quba that likes to purify themselves, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the leader of the clans in Quba, which was Amr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he asked him, "What special purification do you people do in Quba? Why it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed an ayat saying that you love to purify yourself? What special purification do you do?" And Amr radiallahu anhu, he says, "Our custom here in Quba is that whenever we do istinja, we use clay as well as water. Normally those in Makkah, they used to use clay alone or either water alone. But in Quba, they would use both clay and water to clean themselves after the call of nature." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, definitely this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that you are people who love to purify. And he said to him, you should always hold on to this practice which you are doing. In our time, we don't use clay, but what we have the toilet paper as well as water. So we should not be using one only. We should do a combination of both, and we'll be just as the people of Cuba who love to purify as well. Since this was the first masjid the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself built, it was very close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is Masjid Quba. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even after he went into Medina and had his own masjid, which is Masjid al-Nabawi, which is in Medina, he would still come to Masjid Quba. It is mentioned every Saturday, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go to Masjid Quba to perform 2 rakat salat. He would go there to perform 2 rakat salat. And sometimes it is mentioned by the companions that sometimes he will go walking and sometimes he will go riding, because the distance is not that far. So sometimes he will just walk, take a Saturday walk to walk down and pray 2 rakat in Masjid Quba. Sometimes he will ride to Masjid Quba and pray those 2 rakat. And Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he also said in one hadith, whoever makes wudu at home and then goes to Masjid Quba and prays 2 rakat salat in Masjid Quba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give him the blessings as if he has performed an umrah. You get the blessings of performing an umrah just to pray 2 rakat salat in Masjid Quba. So this is the journey to Masjid Quba. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he stayed there a few days, and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he left. As for the entire journey, we mentioned that he left Makkah on Thursday. The Thursday, it was the 27th of Safar. So the migration started from the 27th of Safar. That is when he left Makkah on that Thursday. And then they stayed in the cave of Thawr for 3 days, which would have been the 28th, 29th, and 30th. So they spent that 3 days of Safar, the last 3 days of Safar, in the cave of Thawr. And on Monday, the 1st of Rabi al-Awwal, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left the cave heading towards Quba. So it was on a Monday he left the cave going towards Quba, the 1st of Rabi al-Awwal. And then on Monday, the next Monday, which would have been the 8th of Rabi al-Awwal, he arrived at Quba. So he arrived in Quba the Monday after. So Monday left the cave, next Monday he reaches Masjid Quba, 1 week exact he took from the cave to Masjid Quba. And then he stayed in Masjid Quba until the Friday. So the 8th, he reached Quba, he stayed there the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And on the Friday, which is known as the 13th of Rabi al-Awwal, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he departed from Masjid Quba. So he spent that week, that few days in Masjid Quba. So he left there on the Friday. But before he left, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam delivered, as you could say, the first khutbah in Masjid Quba. Because in these few days, the masjid was built. He went there Monday, started to build the masjid. Even if it took 2 days or so to build the masjid, then on the Friday, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam delivered the first khutbah in Masjid Quba. And inshallah, next week we are going to go through the khutbah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he delivered in Masjid Quba. This was his first khutbah in Masjid Quba, and the first khutbah that was ever delivered as a Friday khutbah. So with this, inshallah, we end. Next week, inshallah, we'll continue. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanakallah wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.